Welcome to the Akan Coker Report. Today we're incredibly honored and happy to have James Lindsay. James Lindsay is an American-born author, mathematician, a political commentator. He's written a number of books that span a number of different subjects, including religion, the philosophy of science, as well as postmodern theory. His most recent book is a wonderful book called Critical Race Theory that he's written with Helen Pluckrose. He's here to discuss some incredibly important concepts and how they relate to medicine that really come from that book. He's also co-founder of New Discourses, which is a platform Dr. Lindsay is using to educate folks about some of the things that he's writing about. So welcome. Thank you so much for coming on.
Thanks for having me. Hopefully we can clear some things up for people.
Absolutely. Your book, which is really well done and well laid out, I really liked how you kind of took folks through from the start in terms of what this theory is. For some of our audience, we're not that familiar. Many of us most of the time are spending our time taking care of patients, trying to learn cardiology, trying to learn heart rhythms and whatnot. And we're starting to see some impacts of what you're talking about. Could you help explain what postmodern theory is?
Yeah, so the book, Cynical Theories, which we just had come out last month, it's the month before last, it came out in August. Time is flying in the pandemic, is supposed to kind of tell the story of this character that we named Theory, which is short for postmodern theory, that has kind of picked up a bunch of other elements. The postmodernists actually did call what they did theory, like theory of everything, not theory of this thing or that thing, but they had the theory, the social theory, basically a socio-political theory of everything. And the book starts off by outlining how they thought. And so it's a huge subject. It's a subject that intentionally defies defining. People who participated in it bristled at being called postmodernists, for example. And so it's really hard to nail down what it is, but that was part of our purpose by working kind of backwards from today to see what's persisted through time, what's lasted through time. We have kind of a functional definition of postmodern theory that involves a couple of key points that we called the two postmodern principles. One of those principles is the knowledge principle. It believes that knowledge is socially constructed. This is something we're hearing a lot about. We just saw it from even the Mathematics Association of America, that we think that math is objective and that math is rooted in science or rooted in objective facts, and that's what they're supposed to be doing. But in fact, they arose in social contexts, which means they arose in political contexts. And what they're actually implying there is that they arose in kind of evil socio-political contexts like racism or sexism or misogyny or fascism or white supremacy. And those biases have colored the construction of knowledge, even within mathematics, even within science, and certainly within medicine. The second of these principles is the postmodern political principle, which is to say that there, along with that social construction of knowledge, comes political power. If you can convince people that what you're saying counts as truth, then that status carries power. And so the postmodern construction of the world sees that the groups that have the power to assign or adjudicate truth are unfairly biased toward being able to put forward their power. And they tend to believe also that power is typically full of blind spots and that it's self-referential and self-interested and works primarily to maintain its own power and self-interest. So the overarching idea here of postmodernism, without getting into the different themes of how it proceeds, but we can talk about those if you want to, is that it believes that knowledge and power are inextricably combined, and that powerful groups in society get to pick and choose what is going to be considered true, what is going to be considered knowledge, what is going to be considered the right way to interpret things in terms of meaning. And they do so unaware of their own biases and self-interest, and therefore perpetuate the problems of society that plague their unique cultural contingencies. And that needs to be overturned and challenged at basically every turn through, in particular, a method that was called deconstruction, which is to show that the things that people believe are knowledge are usually full of absurdity if you take them to their kind of logical limits. And so we shouldn't believe them. And we should open our minds to other potentialities, if you kind of want to speak postmodern about it for a moment. So that's the general idea of postmodern theory.
The at the heart of postmodern theory is this is somewhat of a rejection of modernism and modernity. Correct.
That's right.
So, you know, we have kind of arrived here, basically. And please correct me if I'm misspeaking. With what's traditionally thought of as Enlightenment thinking, correct?
That's right. Yeah.
Where objective reality, you know, is formed based on some methods that have been developed over time. So, you know, in my field, I'm a cardiologist, the scientific method, you know, allows us to kind of build and allows us to progress. And you know, postmodernism kind of is trying to turn all that on its head.
That's right.
And it does so. It's easy to see in the social sciences that it's, you know, how that can happen. Is this something that has been happening for a very long time in the social sciences, and now it's seeping into the more hard sciences, if you will?
Yes, it's a little complicated, but that's certainly been the trajectory. In medicine, of course, sort of, because it so heavily interfaces with the patients, with the human, that it sort of straddles the hard science, soft science divide just a little bit. I guess a tight way to explain how postmodernism would see things, if you want to compare it to Enlightenment thinking, which you are right to do, it is a rejection of Enlightenment thinking, is where the Enlightenment kind of said that human beings can be rational. We can use our rational faculties. We can rely on empirical or scientific inquiry to get good answers about the world that we can trust to be reliable. We can set ourselves aside by asking the question of the world, that's the experiment, to see what it tells us is true. And it doesn't matter who does that. That's the core of knowledge production from Enlightenment thinking. And what postmodernism would say is, who came up with that, and who does it benefit to think that way, and who does it not benefit to think that way? So anybody who wants to make a claim that they are not best served by evidence and by reason, whether they are right or wrong in that, is favored by postmodernism as saying something important and valuable. And so that's where you'll see that lived experience gets elevated above hard evidence, for example, or rational or logically derived conclusions. And that's an extremely important point. I have a nice example we can talk about within medicine if you want to. I think every doctor in the universe will be familiar with a rather alarmed patient coming in only to find out that they have some very banal thing like a muscle cramp or gas or something like that. And they're sure that they're dying of cancer or heart attack or whatever. And it's usually, sometimes it is that, but the point is that you actually have to do tests to find out what it is and then trust the results of the test. The lived experience is actually often misleading, not properly leading. So this actually boiled up, of course, within circles of philosophy, in a particular within certain circles of philosophy like linguistics, and kind of I hesitate to call it the philosophy of science. It's more like the philosophy about science, which is certainly not, it doesn't describe how science works. It just kind of complained about how science wasn't perfect. And so it was a very particular corner of philosophical thought. So it didn't really develop very far in that capacity, although it did influence some social scientists early on. It got initially taken up in the United States by English departments. In fact, the English department at Yale is the first one to have taken up postmodern theory explicitly. So it actually arose within the humanities before it arose within the social sciences. And it started to color how social science saw itself. Of course, Foucault and Derrida, especially Foucault, was very heavily cited in the social sciences. Largely these kind of activists working within humanities departments like English departments that were taking it up were kind of driving it. So that its relationship to activism after it got taken up in the, I guess around 1980 or so, a little earlier than that at Yale, that relationship to activism is where it started to push. And so they've had tremendous success at penetrating into the social sciences. Anthropology is split before this summer, at least, where everything seems to have picked it up in a hurry. I would have said that anthropology split pretty close to down the middle. It's probably much worse than that now. Sociology, the best guess from talking to sociologists that I'd had is that it's split roughly about one third are have taken these methods up and about two thirds haven't. And psychology is similar, but probably closer to a fifth or a quarter, so not quite as bad. And of course, all bets are off now. It's mainlining everywhere. And they've had an explicit agenda to spread into other fields. In fact, as the activists have taken it up and developed it, in the book we talk about the development from postmodernism to applied postmodernism, where activists repackaged it for application. There was a paper in 2016 that's called Women's Studies as a Virus. That's genuinely the title of it. They compare themselves favorably to viruses that weaken the immune system, like HIV and Ebola. They say that this is an ideal pedagogy or an ideal theory for transformational change for studies like women's studies, for these kind of identity-based disciplines. And they suggest that viruses that you might model off of, like HPV, that tend to cause cancer, well, those are also an ideal model, because what they do is they, cancer represents transformational change that's lasting. So they literally do compare themselves favorably to HIV, Ebola, and cancer. Which is sort of alarming, but they've had this mindset, right, that they were going to instruct students, hopefully mostly at undergraduate levels through either elective courses or even through direct courses of study or double majors, and then have those people go into graduate and professional programs and begin to infect their disciplines. And as some of your listeners may or may not know, as you may or may not know, 2 years ago, two colleagues of mine and I came forward with what's known as the grievance studies affair, where we published a spate of fake papers going into these disciplines in the theoretical journals for these disciplines in the theoretical humanities. No social science journals picked us up. But one of them was actually a bid for what we called a feminist astronomy. It didn't get very much attention, but one of the reviewers wrote back that they very much sympathized with this project, because while they've had a great deal of success at penetrating into the softer sciences, they've had very little getting into the hard sciences, and this is a good bid to do so. So the will to push their worldview and the activism underneath it and the mentality in which it's to be approached, this question at the heart of it is, whose interest does it serve to think this way? That has been a deliberate mission to spread from these philosophers through humanities departments to social sciences, and then into the hard sciences to whatever degree they can. And that's even hitting, you know, astronomy, math, physics now, and certainly medicine. I mean, a lot of the medical journals, New England Journal of Medicine, The Lancet, are publishing essays about this in nearly every issue now, which is alarming.
You describe nicely a couple principles, right? The that all of this is based on, and you do a great job of clarifying what they are. So there's the postmodern knowledge principle, where radical skepticism about whether objective knowledge or truth is obtainable, and a commitment to cultural constructivism. Also the postmodern political principle, where, you know, belief that society is formed of systems of power and hierarchies which decide what can be known and how. And this forms the basis for their generation of knowledge. So whereas before you had enlightenment principles, which, you know, a patient comes in with some type of symptom and you go about doing, you know, tests via the scientific method or what have you to try to sort out, is this real? What is the next step that we must take to investigate this? This really involves a group of folks that say knowledge, you know, knowledge is what we say it is. Is that a reasonable.
It is that knowledge, yeah, it is that it's that each kind of cultural group in the world or in society has its own understanding of what constitutes knowledge. And then that those kind of fight with one another for primacy, and primacy is determined by who has the most political power. A really relevant example of this that I thought of while you were just saying that is actually within medicine, is Western medicine versus what you might call Chinese medicine. And so we would say, using Enlightenment principles, that doctors in China, for example, who have various, you know, uses for their Chinese medicine, traditional medicine in China, and they can take up, they can look at the Western medicine, they can look at what happens with the patients, they can look at the outcomes, they can do the experiments themselves and realize what we call Western medicine or just medicine works, and then choose to adopt it. What the postmodern view of this would say is that Western hegemonic power is brainwashing the Chinese into believing that our methods are better than their methods, and that they're unfairly excluding those traditional methods. And therefore, in any given evaluation, say a scientific trial or whatever, we have to kind of give, I mean, in the sense of like a golf game or a bowling game, handicap points to the marginalized knowledge and elevate it higher than the evidence warrants, because the claim is that the white Western approach has had so much power globally, and particularly, of course, throughout the so-called West, that it cheats. It just asserts its own dominance and creates political conditions under which other cultures have to kind of bend the knee to it. So, I mean, this is genuinely actually an issue that comes up within this discussion with Chinese, especially Chinese Americans, I've heard, that have taken up the kind of applied postmodern worldview, are very insistent, you know, that, oh, well, the reason that we aren't using acupuncture and we aren't using herbal decoctions and tinctures and so on is primarily because Western medicine doesn't value our ways of knowing as highly as they values its own. And so they're acting as in prejudice against Chinese people and Chinese culture, right, rather than by evidence.
It's interesting. You know, I mean, I thought Foucault had a point when he said that, you know, when he kind of forward this idea that, you know, we all have cultural biases that we, you know, that exist within us, within our, you know, lived experiences, whatever, where we live. And so, you know, our reality or truth is must be impacted by that. But this seems to be a very warped version of this that has gone, you know, that's gone well beyond that. I mean, when you read Foucault, and is that something that's reasonable?
He's actually very insightful. I don't want to give this impression like he's just this French madman who wrote down all this crazy stuff. Part of the reason we called the book Cynical Theories is particularly based off of, it's based off of a lot of things, but one of them is his analysis itself. So Foucault was he did these things he called at first archaeologies of knowledge, and then later he called them genealogies of knowledge. And what he did was he looked at, say, the history of science as it pertained to mental illness, or the history of science as it pertained to sexuality. And he kind of has this like dismal progression where we thought this way, and then we got a little further down the line and we thought this other way, and it was still terrible. Look how bad it still was. And then we thought this other way and it was still terrible. Look how bad it still was. And so today we probably are still terrible, and our descendants, you know, in the next generation will figure this out. And it's really a kind of, you know, easy way to erase that genuine progress is being made when you go from it's evil spirits to it's a psychological illness. Even if the understanding of psychological illness is bad and the treatment is still really bad, that's actually progress if you go from evil spirits to something that actually has something to do with the brain. But it's easy to erase that progress. And so that kind of cynical read on history was something that you know, is important to remember when you look at him. But that said, he was also very insightful. He was very actually good in some ways on understanding the way that one's cultural biases can easily shape the way you think, that they can blind you to certain assumptions that you're not examining carefully enough. They can, I mean, an example, I guess, to just pull one out of medicine would be that there's been a longstanding bias toward examining men or doing medical experimentation on men rather than women, which of course was kind of a protective thing from the degree that I understand it. Don't experiment on your baby makers, more or less. And, you know, men are more expendable in terms of the reproductive function. And there's been this whole like culture of protecting women. Well, as a cardiologist, you of course would know that the symptoms of a heart attack are different for men and women. And this has been a big thing that came out in the past few years. Like, oh my gosh, all these women might have been dying of heart attacks because patriarchal medicine was ignoring the way that women's symptoms present, because they obviously undervalue women, but in fact, it probably was that they overvalued women, but beside the point. So you get these kind of assumptions, you know, like, oh, well, it's better not to experiment on women. And you maybe don't question what those assumptions, what the consequences of those assumptions would be, as far as you should. And so, he was quite insightful about the way that those biases can influence what we know and what we think we know and how we decide to step up and say, you know, no, this is what the facts are. We already know the facts, without being willing to listen to something outside of that, as Foucault phrased it, a truth regime. So that was really good. But as you also said, he went way too far with it to the point where it's, you know, literally getting it kind of, you know, the people who took him up especially literally start getting it backwards on his kind of cynical read. So it's no longer, oh, well, we were trying to be benevolently sexist and protective of women. It's now, oh, it was a patriarchal plot to not value the experiences of women. You know, it becomes this very negative, bad intention kind of read on things. And then to believe that it's so deeply ingrained that even science itself, which if you understand the basic premises of science is supposed to be, it doesn't matter who does the experiment, right? The results will come out the same. So to say that science itself is just trapped in these biases rather than a self-correcting process that's designed to get away from those sorts of biases by its very design was a step way too far. And so it, again, opens up the door to subjective analyses where an objective analysis would probably often be better.
Yeah, as a quick aside to your point about the gender gap in men and women, I've been attending for 10 years, you know, training for God knows how many 10, 12 years prior to that. And so, you know, we're sitting in hospitals and sitting in cardiac critical care units, patients coming in, we're on the floors, patients coming in chest pain. And the vast majority of folks that I see are men with coronary disease, with heart disease. And then in the last 4 or 5 years, I've been seeing this increasing tide of, this chatter about women and heart disease, how women are ignored, et cetera, and how it's especially dangerous. You brought up the idea that symptom-wise, women are much, women may have very different symptoms and they may be much more atypical. And so you really need to look hard. And one of the really interesting things when I actually looked and went to the CDC Wonder database and pulled this stuff up, the rates of men dying relative to women, again, along with my lived experiences for the last 15, 20 years, is exactly that. Men have coronary disease and die of coronary disease at rates that are significantly higher than women, right? In the ages of 35 to 44, twice as many men are dying as women, 45, 54, three times as many.
Wow.
And so the only reason it ends up being that women die, there may be more women that are dying than men, is because there are more women and eventually you have to die of something.
So
by the time you get to the 85 plus, you know, there's something like 301,000 or sorry, 3 million women left versus 1 million men left. There's three times as many 85 plus year old women than there are men, because all the men have already died.
Right,
off.
Yeah.
And so now 85 plus year old women, you know, out of that large population, there's a significant number that are dying. And so it catches up. So it's interesting. And then when you actually look at the symptom difference, actually most of the time women do present with chest discomfort or nausea. The difference is like, it's like 5-10%, but it's not something like, you know, some ridiculous thing. So it's really interesting. And I wondered, because it was around the same time that I was starting to read work by you and Dr. Pluckrose and Dr. Boghossian, And I kind of wondered, I was like, is this kind of partly related to what these guys are talking about? Back to what you're talking about, Foucault, which is really interesting. There's this idea that everything in this world where you're creating this knowledge is kind of built on this idea of power and this power dynamic. Can you talk about why that is and what's going on with that?
Sure. I mean, Foucault actually explicitly believed that knowledge and power are two sides of the same coin. You know, we've all heard knowledge is power. I think that's even Francis Bacon, but I'm not positive if that's the origin of that aphorism. But Foucault believed it literally, like there is points in both directions. Knowledge is power and power is knowledge. They're exactly the same thing. And that the working of power in society is primarily achieved by those people who have the authority to decide what is and is not going to count as knowledge. What's the scientists, the leaders who administrate and put the policy into practice based on what the scientists maybe recommend or not. Even the journalists to some degree who report, as we've just kind of experienced, I had to run on the reporting since I'm not a cardiologist that the symptoms are different. Of course, the reporters blew that out of proportion from what you're telling me. So my information was wrong. So these people have an absurd amount of power, according to Foucault. And then what happens is that these ideas about what is acceptable, what is true, what is false, what is crazy, what is way outside the realm of reasonable discourse, that for him, that those were all just exertions of power that everybody kind of takes up, and it works through everybody kind of like an electric power grid. It's really kind of funny, because if you look at the different people who analyze power through history of Marx, and he's thinking, oh, well, it's like this weight that presses down from the powerful interest groups in society, and they smash everybody down like a machine, like in the middle of the industrial age. And now we have electricity, and we have these big grid, electrical grids that everything works through. And Foucault's like, no, power works like an electric grid. And it's like, I wonder where they're getting their metaphors for how it works. So their assumption, though, following Foucault, so Foucault actually had this belief that people make truth claims. Okay. So maybe it's a factual claim about somebody's health. Maybe it's a factual claim about the status of medicine or whatever. And maybe it's gravity. And they make factual claims. And for Foucault, he said, whether a factual claim is true or false isn't particularly interesting. In fact, it misses the point. The point is that there is a system of power that allowed us to believe it was true. And that system of power is the interesting thing that we should be paying attention to. So what we end up with is, when people take up this line of thought, is a gigantic distraction. Instead of thinking about whether or not a claim on the truth, a hypothesis or a theory, is genuinely true or false, they're caught up in this kind of tornado of, well, who made the claim and who does it benefit? Does it benefit themselves? How does it benefit them? And so it all kind of turns into this kind of sludge of murky sociology to analyze the power and the power dynamics. And then again, to assert that even the idea that somebody would have the chutzpah to say, this is knowledge, we know this, it's true, look at the chart, look at the graph, look at the data. That itself is an assertion of power by the people who assigned themselves, that role to say that such a thing counts as knowledge. So you have this, or counts as, well, yeah, knowledge and thus power. And so it's a really big distraction for people who end up taking this line of thought up. It actually becomes an obsession with the idea of power and the belief that social power somehow underlies everything. Right. Yep. And in today's world, the way that it was not for Foucault, Foucault was definitely not interested in identity politics. And he thought that he did not think about cultures or anything in terms of, say, race or something like that. But today we do. So now it's, how is white supremacy baked into your medical chart? How is homophobia baked into your medical chart? And all of these kind of identity-based power dynamics.
And this is so important because, I think there's a general sense in a lot of physicians, a lot of folks that are in the sciences that, well, we'll let the science decide. We'll let, here's a chart to show you why this claim is wrong or not. But that's not going to be acceptable. that's not acceptable, because you know the rejoinder is going to be, you know, that chart and that data, the way you collected it, and we see that, and we're seeing this all the time in medicine too, that you know this has been collected in a way, you know, because of the power structures that exist, that is unfair, is oppressive, and therefore it isn't real.
That's right.
You know,
it's actually part of the problem. An example of that happened at the Evergreen State College, which famously melted down 3 years ago or so.
Yeah.
And a friend of mine, Brett Weinstein, was the professor there. And in one of the many meltdown incidents of the college, you know, the students had kind of cornered him and they were yelling at him and they were saying, this is a racist college. This is a white supremacist college. And of course, this is a super liberal college in Olympia, Washington, which probably is not very racist at all. And it's like one of the least racist places on the planet, more than likely. And so he says, well, fine, show me the evidence. Let's look at the evidence and let's do something about it. And the response that he got was, if you lived racism, you would know it's there. You wouldn't need to ask for evidence. So that you even ask for evidence is proof that you also are a racist, and you're asking for racist evidence because it might deny our lived experience, which is authoritative here. And that's a catastrophe in the making, to claim that the evidence itself, to claim to look at the evidence itself is in fact an act of hegemonic power that's trying to marginalize the view of the person yelling at you. And thus is in a practical sense is inflaming them further, is a catastrophe for being able to resolve differences of opinion, first of all, in a reasonable manner, but also to answer the question at hand, is there racism here? Is there a bias here that actually needs to be addressed? And then of course, worst of all, in the meantime, all of the results that matter are not being taken care of. I don't know the details, but I know there's like this massive fight in medicine around, in nephrology, around some kidney marker, right, that apparently varies by race. And people are saying, oh, it's biological racism to say that. And it's like, well, you're going to kill Black people if you get their numbers wrong. So you might want to not do that. And then that's biological racism. You know, race can't have any biological component whatsoever. And so it's very frustrating, because what you'll end up with is not necessarily a patient, but you'll usually end up with either an administrator or another medical professional who's drank a bit of this Kool-Aid, who's going to come in and start making a mess about that and asserting it. And you'll end up in these kind of decision dilemmas. Do I override, right, this person who's making this claim and save a life or prevent kidney damage or whatever it happens to be? Or do I kind of shrug my shoulders and say, you know what? Okay, good luck.
Right. Yeah, no, yeah. It's a nice example for us that a lot of our listeners will know, where, you know, researchers, I forget now in the 80s or maybe in the late 80s, in order to better fit, we don't have, you know, the way to measure your kidney function can be somewhat of an arduous task. And you know, you have to pee into something for 24 hours, keep it chilled, and then measure the amount of creatinine that's being cleared. Now, you know, that's a little arduous to do. So we've developed, people have developed, you know, a blood test of a serum creatinine. And then it turned out, when folks were basically doing some type of curve fitting analyses, that when you looked at self-identified race, there was a difference when you correlated, you know, the gold standard with what the serum creatinine was. And you know, they were very well intentioned. The idea was to get a better approximation of what the actual creatinine was. And so that's why this race-based formula came up, simply because it seemed like if you corrected for it by race, that you would get this different, you know, you'd get a more accurate result, which would allow you to treat the patient better. And that has been decried as, you know, by as being racist and part of this structure that we're in. And it's given frequently as an example of why medicine is systemically racist.
Right. So, of course, just to compare, the Enlightenment rational view of this would say, okay, now we have an open question on this issue. Let's start doing the experiments. Let's find out what's true, and let's let the cards fall where nature says the cards fall, where people's actual bodies. Let's do the experiment. Let's see what happens. And whereas this ideology, instead, the critical race theory, says to even ask the question is racist, don't do it. This is just proof of just how racist medicine is, because it's taking race into an account. and it's therefore not admitting one of critical race theory's central contentions is that race is wholly socially constructed. In fact, it was socially constructed by white people for the purpose of doing racism. So to bring up race at all is already to enact racism, according to the underlying assumptions of critical race theory. So of course, race is a very low resolution way to talk about different biological populations, but nevertheless, it's like the first step in that process. Of course, it's low resolution, but most first pass filters are pretty low res. And so the argument in its deep desperation to avoid talking about socially constructed categories of race and saying that they're always racist misses that there are actually, you know, although minute, sometimes biological differences between different populations from different regions who would have also had other things like melanin counts that range, or, you know, different structural issues, changes with their eyelids in East Asia, for example, and maybe there's some others, bone density, I don't know what they are. Certainly skin color, hair texture, and certain things are pretty identifiable and consistent. So there are actual differences, some of which may or may not be medically relevant. So it seems very important to be able to ask the question and do the investigation. Maybe race isn't the best way to do that. Maybe, you know, now that we can do some DNA sequencing, right, biological population group is the better way to do it. But we're still kind of stuck with these low res categories, and especially at administrative levels, we're sort of stuck with them, and they work as kind of a first pass filter. So it's like being so obsessed about possibly being racist through some tortured argument that you throw away an important kind of analysis that might really matter. And even to be able to answer the question of whether or not it matters is kind of put on the chopping block. So you can see how it's sort of very irresponsible, and it doesn't matter like which side of the argument you fall on regarding kidney stuff. It doesn't matter. The point is you should be able to ask the question to do the experiment and then defer to what the answer is,
right,
without being accused of being kind of like the worst sort of person in the universe. Right.
Do you think that is it fair to say that, say, you know, you transport yourself back to, 1780, there isn't an empiric argument to be made against slavery in 1780, right? I mean, there's nothing that, you know, a white slave owner can say in 1780 that's going to make slavery okay. Is it the case that, you know, whether it be slavery, whether it be the women's rights movement, civil rights movements later on, did all that progress happen under the guise of liberalism, or did it actually happen under the guise of, you know, some version of postmodernism?
Okay, so you are correct. And just to give credit where it's due, not that it's a very difficult thing to ascertain, historians know it without any of their analysis as well. Certainly the categories of race that we know and will say kind of sarcastically love today were generated by people who had a very poor understanding that we would now recognize as being unscientific, not even quite proto-scientific, but who had stumbled across the idea of heritability in mostly the 16th and 17th centuries. And so that they are correct. The critical racers are correct to say that the categories of race were invented by people who assigned themselves a status of white so that they could justify slavery and justify colonialism, which, as you pointed out, should have been unjustifiable. I would argue that certainly postmodernism could not have been responsible for unmaking these problems, as postmodernism and philosophy first started to kind of develop in the late 1960s and then really took off through the 1970s. And the Civil Rights Act, for example, was passed in 1964. So postmodernism certainly wasn't, and it wasn't even in the US, it was all in France until, you know, the late 1970s. So certainly postmodernism itself did not solve the problem. Now you could take a step back and say, well, what about critical theory, which is this kind of like, let's question the assumptions and everything. Well, that developed in 1920. And we figured out abolitionism in the United States by 1863. So again, critical theory probably wasn't the thing that led us to figure out that racism was bad. it probably also wasn't the thing that led to the abolishment of Jim Crow and segregation and redlining and all of that with the Civil Rights Act. And the reason is because you can see in that, not to say it didn't play any role, but you can see historically that you had kind of in a very archetype-based grand narrative sort of storytelling capacity, you had the Martin Luther King camp versus the Malcolm X camp. And it's not to say that both didn't play some role, but Malcolm X was very much more in the critical theory school of things, whereas Martin Luther King was very much in the liberal, let's live up to the same, to the promise of our Constitution. And he said, you know, we're not going to judge by the color of skin, we're going to judge by the content of character. Kind of an all men are created equal thing. The exact same thing Frederick Douglass talked about in 1852 or three with his famous 4th of July speech, just before slavery finally collapsed, you know, a decade or so before slavery finally collapsed. And so you have these principles that were laid down by primarily the, as they're known, the Scottish liberals, Locke, Paine, Jefferson, Madison, as they were in the American context, somewhat but less the French liberal thinkers who, you know, egalitarianism, fraternity, freedom, and so on. Some of that, though, because egalitarianism, these ideals kind of entered this melting pot of ideas of liberalism that became the engine. So everybody says, oh, well, the African slave trade was so horrible, and they're correct. It was a particularly brutal form of slavery. It was a particularly badly justified form of slavery. It was also something that up until the mid-19th century was happening kind of all over the world in all different cultures, but just in different degrees and for different reasons with different justifications. And it's still happening today in certain parts of the world that nobody would describe as liberal. And so it's the liberal democracies that took up these values of liberalism and then fought for them and stood for them and fought for them and stood for them and fought for them and stood for them, often alongside radicals who were a bit more nutty, who achieved these changes. So you can look, for example, at the women's suffrage movement, which finally succeeded in 1920. Is that right? 1918, 1920, thereabouts. And the first wave feminism, as it's called. And some of them were liberal reformers and some of them were outright Marxists. And it's just how it is. And they kind of, again, you have this sort of dichotomy, the Martin Luther King versus Malcolm X approach. And I don't know how to parse who was more relevant to it, but we do know that the liberal aspects of those arguments, whatever the radicals achieved in terms of opening public sentiment, the liberal side is what won public support. The liberal side is what moved the ball. The liberal values, maybe with the irritation and agitation of the radicals, is what ended up making the changes. So I think that liberalism, again, this is why we called it cynical theories. It's very easy to look back at the history of the United States and say, 1619, how awful. And before that, you know, the Native Americans, how awful. And then slavery, how awful. And then Jefferson kept slaves, how awful. And then we got rid of slaves, but Abraham Lincoln wanted to get rid of all of the black people because he didn't know what to do with them. How awful, how awful, how awful. And it's so easy to forget that these ideals, and maybe the United States didn't do them as well as, say, the UK or France or some other country at different times and different places, these ideals installed in these different places that we now refer to as Western democracies were the first places in human history to create a steady march toward equality, egalitarianism, fairness before the law, equality before the law, and genuine, you know, scientific progress, which can be seen, you know, over the march of the last 500 years from, you know, kind of not a great place that they call the Dark Ages now to us having a Zoom call and us having having cardiologists, since it, like, you're not sticking a leech on my forehead if my chest hurts or something. So there's been a lot of progress, and it's easy to forget that by looking at how terrible things have been and how slow and painful that's been. But I do think it was the liberal values, and certainly it wasn't postmodernism. Postmodernism didn't even burst on the English speaking scene until 1980. Yeah. So how could it have done it?
Yeah, I think you very nicely, you know, I'm not going to have you go through it completely on here just from a time standpoint, but you very nicely in your book, make that clear distinction between postmodernism and liberalism, and right. You know, and that two exist, you know, they don't exist necessarily side by side right now in 2020. They're actually in tension with one each other. They're opposed to one another. And you know, you make the strong case, which I'm certainly partial to, that, you know, progress, and as you've just outlined as well, progress has happened within that umbrella of liberalism, not necessarily within, you know, what people think postmodernism is.
Sure. I mean, on a just a very simple arc of history that's easy to understand in light of what I just said, with critical race theory specifically, like I said, they were correct to identify that certain people who wanted to do colonialism and a slave trade, European people in the 16th and 17th centuries, and then going forward until the mid 19th century at least, came up with these ideas of race and racism to justify their own atrocities. They're very accurate to say that what happened was certain people with power put a certain kind of social significance into racial categories. Our argument in the book is that liberalism was a set of principles that let us chip away at that very successfully over painful centuries. And then right when we get to the point where we're not all the way to equality, and where nobody's insane and claiming everything's perfect, nobody has racism anymore, nobody's making it, but we're getting very close to a post-racist society, in steps these people and says, literally, we could read the paragraph from chapter 5 where we're quoting them, their paragraph. We have to put social significance back into racial categories, because if we don't, then we're going to put people's universal humanity in front of their identity group, which would not be fruitful for identity politics. That was Kimberly Crenshaw, one of the founders of critical race theory's argument. So you have this arc of history that's people put social significance in racial categories. That was bad. Bad things happened. Chipped away with liberal principles for centuries, finally almost get rid of it, and the group of radicals show up and say, nope, put it back. And that's really as stark as it gets. That's the choice that we're looking at right now. That's the tension that we're looking at.
Before I ask my next question, then I have to ask a follow-up. Why are they doing this? What's the agenda?
There's a lot of guesses. You know, it's hard to read people's psychology, which is ultimately, you know, from afar, it's just ultimately what's going on. Part of it, if we want to be very fair about it, is
you're on the verge of a better society, and it literally seems like, and certainly it seems like in medicine, you want to go back backwards to, you know, identity politics, and, you know, instead of living in this nice post-racial world that liberals like me thought we were working towards, what is it? Why do they want to do it?
So my guess is, honestly, anytime you have a big social movement that is on, you know, that's dealing with something that's legitimately unfair, right? Like racism is legitimately unfair. Yeah. Not was really, because it was institutional and all of that. You have a large coalition of people who are usually working together in that social movement. And so most of them are of the kind of fairly reasonable approach who, when they start to see, you know, they get the piece of legislation, maybe it's a Civil Rights Act, they start to see the big scale changes, they start to see the legal battles being won, and you know, things are, they kind of walk away. Well, who doesn't walk away? Well, it's the crazy radical people, right? And so you end up with a situation where the only people kind of left doing it are these very concentrated, frustrated radicals who are seeing the problem everywhere, and that's kind of what they do. And then they are living in a very complex world, because big problems like racism don't just go away. They take probably generations to go away after they're struck down legally and institutionally. So you have this world, like, you got to picture yourself in the 80s and the 90s when this stuff was really flaring up, where definitely racism was like a lot worse even than it is today. It was still kind of a significant thing, but it was illegal, but it was still happening. And so there's this very frustrating tension there for people who, and a lot of people are like, well, you know, we've got it now, we've moved on. So there's this very frustrating kind of perspective that would motivate radical people to get very deeply entrenched into that kind of thing. Now, one of the things is that they start with, if we want to be very generous to their view, is you can't fix a problem you won't talk about. You can't fix a problem you won't look at. And in some sense, they aren't totally wrong. If we completely ignore race, if we completely went full colorblind, we would become, and I mean in a naive sense of never seeing that race can possibly matter for anything, in terms of social interactions, we would miss a lot of racism. And so you have to focus on it to be able to see it, to call it out, to to get rid of it on some level. Of course, this is one of those things where there's a right amount to do that, and then there, you can go full whole hog. And it turns out when all that's left are very frustrated radicals, they're probably going to go all in on it. And I have a feeling that that's why the civil rights movements, be the racial civil rights movement, the gay pride movement, as it was, especially in its earlier years, and the second wave liberal feminism movement had sort of, they were getting to the point of diminishing returns in their results. The radicals were still very motivated and very angry. There was enough of that, like, you know, I don't want to guess a percentage, but you could imagine, like, if it's like dirty water or whatever, like there's 5% muck in the water, you can still see it and you're really unsatisfied, but it's really hard to get that last 5% of precipitate out. And so it just creates this kind of perfect storm where you, in a kind of a broad view of history, you could see this as kind of like a flare up around a stage, like an overreacting flare up or a cytokine storm around a failing illness or whatever. If you will. I mean, I think of Trump as the cytokine storm actually, but nevertheless.
So to get to, where it seems to be impacting medicine, you know, a reasonable, and we've touched on it a little bit in terms of, you know, the renal function. Oh, we had Dr. Wong, Norman Wong, who is a EP fellowship director, electrophysiology, a specialized field of cardiology, published a paper, peer-reviewed, published a paper on affirmative action. And it was kind of a descriptive history of affirmative action, though one can be reasonably from reading it get the idea that, you know, he stands on a certain side in terms of, you know, whether he's pro or against affirmative action, something that I thought was still allowed in 2020 in America. But you know, that created a firestorm, and he was quickly removed from his post as fellowship director. And then he's also not allowed to work with trainees anymore. This is a man who's been, you know, for years, highly published, well respected. You don't become fellowship director unless you're a good teacher, unless you like working with trainees. You know, that's not some position where, you know, the guy who wants to be in a corner just reading x-rays is. And he's now not allowed to be with trainees because he's deemed to not have a safe environment, because he doesn't, you know, he may have an opinion against, you know, he doesn't think affirmative action may be fair. So
I'm assuming by his name, which maybe is not a good thing to do, that Dr. Wong might not be white also.
He's not white. He's of Asian origin.
I bring this up not to be petulant, but to point out that one's identity matters much less than one's politics, where this gets involved.
Right.
So you have to be on the right side of the issues, and having the we'll say correct identity markers isn't going to save you if you have the wrong politics. The more pop culture version of this was when Kanye West put on the Make America Great Again hat and said, "I think for myself," and Ta-Nehisi Coates came out and said, "You're not black anymore." And so
It's so interesting. There's this in the context, of course, is the American College of Cardiology has this larger diversity initiative. And the diversity initiative is upset, they're upset, and they're upset, and they want to change the demographics of what cardiology is. Cardiology has a lot of men, not nearly enough women, and it is almost entirely white and brown and Asian. Now, when the ACC diversity folks put up a pie chart to represent the problem, you know, they have the nice U.S. demographic with, you know, 15 to 20 or 30% or whatever that's black, and then Hispanic, and then you know, white. Mm-hmm. Interestingly, you know, I've always thought of cardiology and medicine in general as incredibly diverse. I mean, there's tons of Indians, there's Pakistanis, there's Bangladeshis, there's folks from, you know, the Middle East, there's folks from Asian origin. I mean, I think medicine is incredibly diverse. But interestingly, the ACC, when they put up the pie chart of what cardiology looks like, they have, you know, they basically have black, Hispanic, and white, and they lump they lump me and Dr. Wong all, you know, under the white category, which is
y'all are white adjacent. So Yeah, welcome to critical race theory analysis, because that evidence, which would throw a monkey wrench in their narrative, becomes problematic and has to kind of be, we'll say, recontextualized. And so they come up with a kind of a bevy of ideas for this. So white adjacency is one of these. White adjacency essentially means that you kind of have cultural values that are very similar to what they call white cultural values. And if you wonder what those are, you can go look where the National African American History Museum at the Smithsonian put out that helpful chart that said what white culture looks like. And so a lot of times you actually do run into this where Asian, like East Asian Confucian culture has many values in common with sort of the Protestant work ethic for whatever set of reasons.
Indians are never on time to anything, so we cannot be white.
That's probably, that answers a question, you know, just as a kind of amusing aside. I when I was on Joe Rogan's show a couple of months ago, I mentioned that one of the hallmarks of whiteness or white supremacy is wearing a wristwatch. And it's that absurd. And I got challenged on this a little bit. Show me a citation where, and Joe even followed up with me. He's like, could you have a citation for this? So I was like, I know I've seen it somewhere. It's stuck in my head because I saw it and it was just so ridiculous. So I go digging and it turns out that it's a post-colonial scholar, Homi Bhabha, who is from India, who had first mentioned wristwatches in the context of racism. And it turns out that it's the most asinine story you could possibly imagine. And of all coincidences, he's talking about how white culture had been brought to India via the colonialist British, and also through, like, of course, the Sheikh of America. It gets exported everywhere, you know, Hollywood turns into Bollywood and all the rest. And so he actually is describing Donald Trump standing on Fifth Avenue in a suit and a tie and his hair, and then and wearing a big fancy wristwatch, and that this became an image that, you know, colonized Indian people decided to aspire to. They all wanted to be like Donald Trump. And I was like, holy crap, that's where this actually comes from. That's really funny. So, I mean, it's funnier because you said, you know, Indians are never on time, and then colonizing was wristwatches, of course. And that's what his argument was about. But no, these things are kind of the manipulations of data that they're very willing to engage in. They're willing to kind of white adjacent people into whiteness because they apparently, you know, are very readily able, you know, you model minorities are willing to take up white culture very excitedly and enthusiastically.
Right. Which is really amusing because we just spent some time talking about the fact that the power structure is what creates the data, correct? Or is what creates knowledge, or what creates, you know, truth. And that's relative. And and here you have it's like, well, clearly I'm not sitting at the top of the power structure, because, you know, whoever's creating these charts is, you know, creating the data to make it you know, to suit them.
You have now touched upon kind of the central irony, haven't you? the deep lie at the heart of all of this, which is that it certainly seems the power might have shifted if, for example, they get to decide which groups are white for the purposes of making a chart that makes their political point for them, and then, you know, is the basis upon which demands for structural changes to the field, which I'm sure will be overseen by them. And they have a set of consultants who will come in and teach you all how to do it.
Right. So we have an ACC diversity and inclusion task force or something. Right. And it's been operative for a few years. It's been amped up now since the summer, you know, and here, I just wanted to read you a thread from the head of this, right. A short thread. This is in response to Donald Trump, who no doubt follows you on Twitter.
He retweeted me once, actually.
Yeah, you're having, I know, I know that. So,
man, people were mad. They told me I had to denounce him. So I changed my name on Twitter to retweeted by the president for a while.
So Trump, of course, banned, and he called, at least the headline was, he denotes as anti-American. Diversity training is anti-American, right? Mm-hmm. That's a BBC headline. Trump bans anti-American as anti-American in quotes diversity training. And so this gentleman, who's also a cardiologist, who's I think one of the he may lead the diversity task force, says, "I've read the mandate. It's an extremely negative view of diversity, inclusion, anti-racism training or discussions. Training or workshops or discussions can be done poorly in a way that leaves people angry, insulted, defensive. Gee, I can't imagine why. And likely to cling to their worldview even more avidly, or they can be done the right way, in a way that makes it clear that no one is perfect, that we all have a stake in ending bias and oppression, and that there are tools at work, that making the world a better place is all of our responsibility. Ultimately, I find that the biggest contributor to the success or failure of such discussions or workshops is the attitude, heart, and soul of the participant. If they enter with an attitude of this is garbage, I'm only here because my boss made me come, then the training will not make one bit of difference. On the other hand, if the participant enters thinking, I know I'm not perfect, I know the world needs to be better, let's see what I can learn, the odds of positive change are much higher. All this mandate means is that the people in the former group have friends in high places." You know, and a lot of the training here that he's talking about, you know, in from following him, relates to this implicit bias, you know, training, you know, that
really,
you know,
easy to game that test.
Yeah, you know, the implicit association test has been, you know, well documented at this point. But of course, I guess it hasn't made it through to these folks, or they must know it and yet kind of double down on it. Do you see any point to this type of training? I'll say that the underlying base for this is that the reason that we don't have more diversity in medicine, the diversity of the right kind, because I don't count, in medicine, is that there's a ton of implicit bias.
Right.
And that bias is what prevents us from, you know, getting folks in and be more diverse. Is there anything to this? What do you think of?
I mean, first of all, I will say that is actually somewhat of an empirical claim. Of course, implicit bias is a little bit of a fuzzy and screwy concept, or unconscious bias. You know, it's a little weird. But ultimately, this could be adjudicated by carefully gathered data, which doesn't seem to be on the docket. Instead, we're just going to do something now, and we're going to use these trainings to like warp people's minds just in case that's really the cause, which hasn't been determined. So we'll start by saying that, at least in principle, it should be a empirical question that's not being investigated empirically. Second of all, in 2020, to be honest with you, I honestly don't think that anybody is unracially aware. In fact, I think we're a little way too racially aware. And so the problem is unlikely to be located there. It's likely that there are other variables. Many of those variables may be related to the legacies of racism, but not necessarily, or maybe even some to racism itself. And so there's this need for clarity around the various contributing factors to these differences. Sometimes these differences may be relevant, and sometimes they may not be relevant. They may have other underlying factors. It could be down to values. It could be down, especially if it's when it's a male woman man woman thing, it could be down to you know, different features in how people. This is what James Damore got fired for. So you have to be cautious, of course, even daring to say that men and women might have different interests and drives and ways to prioritize their time, or even very kindly that they have different talents on average. Like, I think there's actually some data that shows that men who are good at math are statistically unlikely to be good at writing, whereas women who are good at math are statistically likely to be good at writing. And therefore, you can expect at least some proportion of women who are also good at math to find different career paths because they have more options available to them, which is, I think, a statement to women's intellectual credit, not discredit, to make that point. And yet it gets flipped around. So I don't think so. And of course, I can't stand by, you know, the statement that, oh, this was all just power dynamics, it's friends in high places. Because ultimately, let's accept the hypothesis, which I think is unlikely to be true, but let's accept for the sake of argument the hypothesis that, yeah, we do need more of this kind of diversity and inclusion training. Maybe somehow there are people in professional careers who went through years of college and professional school and didn't already get indoctrinated deeply enough into this way of thinking, who are still kind of curmudgeons and are thinking, oh, those brown people, you know, or something like that. And that further professional training in professional environments might fix them, as opposed to, you know, maybe, I don't know where these people even live anymore. I mean, but let's say that this exists. In that case, the person is right but wrong. They're right. There's a right way to do these kinds of trainings and there are wrong ways to do these kinds of trainings. And it's not all the attitude of the person showing up. Okay. It's also that there are, if you read the executive order, it's worded very carefully. You'll notice if you read the executive order that it also would ban, it never says it explicitly, it doesn't have to. It would also ban white supremacy entirely. It would ban brown supremacy. It would ban black supremacy. It would ban all supremacies equally. It bans racial scapegoating and racial stereotyping, and the same for sex. And so it's written in a way that's actually very equal and very even-handed. So it's not written to say you can't do diversity training. This is a lie we're hearing a lot. You know, even in the presidential debate, Chris Wallace said, you want to ban racial sensitivity training. No, it very specifically bans the use of particular divisive concepts when you approach those trainings. So we can take the person at his word and say there is a right way and a wrong way to do these trainings, supposing they're even necessary. And if we accept that they are, those ways are outlined by the executive order in a way that precludes any one group, race, or sex being able to demonize or scapegoat or accuse or stereotype any other, regardless. And it points equally in all directions, which is kind of the equality thing. Since you, it's actually really funny. I was just sending this before. I'm going to pull up my something off of my phone. You said the whole un-American point, right? So the un-American point turns out to be real. I think I'm going to read this. This is about critical race theory, which is the thing that specifically got banned. There's a book that is titled Critical Race Theory and Introduction by Richard Delgado and Gene Stefanchik. And so this is actually a sentence in the introduction to that book. It says, unlike traditional civil rights, which embraces incrementalism and step-by-step progress, critical race theory questions the very foundations of the liberal order, including equality theory, legal reasoning, enlightenment, rationalism, and principles of constitutional law. So it is un-American, but that's in their book. That's not something we wrote about it. It's not something somebody else wrote about it. That's how they advertise themselves in one of their fundamentally like foundational textbooks, key textbooks that everybody who studies this on a rigorous level in a university is going to have read and worked with. So it is un-American. It fundamentally questions the idea of constitutional law, which is exactly, regardless of how you want to put it, the foundational idea of America. We have constitutional law, and that is the highest, in some sense, law of the land. And from there on out, we're going to get rid of enlightenment rationality. We're going to question the liberal order. I mean, it explicitly says these things. So it seems to me that folks like the guy who wrote this thread, maybe should read some more critical race theory before they start saying that we shouldn't, before they start criticizing an attempt to, in a very even-handed and fair way, limit its negative influences. As a matter of fact, you'll notice that the executive order, if you read it, the original memorandum did name critical race theory and white privilege specifically. They should have added brown privilege, which is a new concept they came up with this summer for folks like yourself. The executive order itself does not ban these things. It bans a number of concepts and approaches. And so if you wanted to take concepts out of critical race theory that you find enlightening, that do not rely on those kinds of assumptions or those practices, those could even still be part of your diversity training. There's no problem there. It's all about, as I've been trying to say for years now, method matters. And it seems that we agree with the thread there. The method matters, but it's a question of which methods.
Well, Dr. Lindsay, thank you so much for coming on. It was really great. Great conversation. I'll just repeat myself from earlier. You know, I think your work is so important because it kind of gives us somewhat of a foundation to kind of stand on. One, because you have to understand what the opposition is not only saying, but where it comes from. And then two, you know, and again, we don't have time, you know, I'm not Joe Rogan, so we can't talk for 3 hours. And two, you know, you very nicely outlined in the later chapters, a path forward. So, you've touched on that in our conversation as well, of course, but really, really great conversation. Thank you. Thank you so much for coming on. Keep up what you're doing.
Yeah. Thanks. Right. I'm glad you're trying to get the word to, to the medical profession because it's so important there. We're going to hear so much about health equity, and health equity is one of those things where there are better and worse approaches. And so we should definitely be, people should be looking, you know, is it based in this kind of divisive nonsense, or is it based in something rigorous, or is it somewhere a little bit, you know, we'll test the waters a little bit of both or whatever. And, you know, my mission is to get people to evaluate these concepts in a clear-eyed fashion. If people want to accept them when they understand them, that's their right, and that's fine. But I am extremely troubled by the fact, and this is what's motivated me to write Cynical Theories, this is what motivated me to create new discourses, that a lot of people seem to be mainlining this stuff into important and absolutely crucial institutions without actually fully understanding what it is. So I'm trying to help people bridge that gap so they don't have to go spend 3 years reading terse, right, obscure academic literature that frankly nobody wants to read.
Right. That's important. You're not saying, and it's clear that you're not saying you're you have a different opinion from these folks, but you make clear throughout your book that we should question these theories. And, you know, you quote, right, from that wonderful essay from John Stuart Mill, which is fantastic, which I recommend everyone read. We'll put it on the show notes. About the idea and the importance of questioning, the importance of debate. And, you know, you have a number of examples in your book. We talked about Dr. Wong and how, you know, he's essentially, you know, anyone who questions these theories is kind of removed, is censored.
Right.
And that's a really, really, dangerous place to be. So once again, thank you so much for coming on.
Yeah, I really do hope people, I read that short sentence from one of their primary sources. On New Discourses, I've even put up what I called a beginner's curriculum with Helen, a beginner's curriculum in critical race theory. I think people should be able to read their sources and make up their own minds. I disagree strongly with what I've read in critical race theory, but don't take my word for it.
Go learn about it.
Yeah, go learn about it yourself too.
Newdiscourses.com, correct?
Correct.
And your Twitter handle, where you're very active?
At Conceptual James, with my apologies to anybody who expects it to be professional.
All right.
I try to be fun there.
It is a lot of fun. All right. Thanks again.